There's a natural affinity between the altered state induced by cannabis, the altered state of consciousness, and the creative attributes of the human mind. Numerous artists have embraced cannabis as a creative catalyst. Writers in particular have benefited from the associational fluidity that cannabis engenders, how it loosens the power of analogy and unleashes the spoken word. And before the written word, of course, is the spoken word. Before literature, there's song. It turns out that in areas of the brain that are very active during a young child's life, when our language acquisition is actually really happening around 2 years old, it's heavily concentrated with cannabinoid receptors, and they're firing at a greater pace at that point than ever before. So there's a link between language acquisition and cannabinoid receptor signaling. Cannabinoid receptors, of course, are the receptors in the human brain and body that respond pharmacologically to compounds in cannabis. Many writers have benefited from the associational fluidity that cannabis engenders. Its ability to unleash the spoken word, loosen the powers of analogy. Before the written word, there is the spoken word. Before literature, there is song. And there's a great many cultural reference points for cannabis as a speech-inducing agent in many different cultures, even the United States. The CIA's predecessor during World War II, the Office of Strategic Services, referred to cannabis as a speech-inducing agent, as a truth serum, get people to spill the beans, enemy spies, and so forth. But many, long before that, in different cultures, such as Central American Indian cultures, actually referred to cannabis, which they use in a ceremonial context, as the herb which makes one speak. In India, ancient India, Tibet as well, referred to cannabis as an herb that impels the flow of words. So there's a natural affinity for literature there. And there's a biological basis for this. Cannabis dilates blood vessels, including blood vessels in the brain. The more the brain's blood vessels are dilated, the more blood will flow through the veins, the more oxygen that is in the brain, the more oxygen, the more thoughts, rush of thoughts. So there's a biological basis for that experience that many people involved in literature claim. When you think about it, one of the very first novels ever written by Francois Rabelais, Gargantua and Pantagruel was hemp. He didn't identify it by name that way, but it's clearly it was an allegory about the hemp plant, or much of that early novel. And he was a satirist. Literature is, again, a relatively recent phenomenon. Before literature, there was the spoken word. There was spoken poems and song. But ever since the 1500s, when the first novel started to be written, cannabis was always part of that. And in the French tradition in particular, it's very pronounced. In the 19th century, we have the Hashish Eaters Club that emerged in the 1840s. It was actually stimulated by... In the early 1800s, a French doctor, Dr. J.J. de Moreau de Tours, visited Egypt, which was a French colony at the time, as much of North Africa was. It was in Napoleon's time, and it was an expansive French empire. When Moreau de Tours went to Egypt, he was like stunned by the amount of hashish consumption in the local population. But he perceived that it actually had a positive effect overall, because he didn't see the same kind of diseases, as a physician now, in Egyptian society as he was seeing in France. And he surmised that it probably had something to do with the fact that in Egypt, hashish was the recreant of choice, rather than alcohol, which has always been frowned upon in the Muslim religion. But not so for hashish. It's been an ambiguous relationship. But he brought some hashish back with him to France. And he was interested in the idea that if you consume hash, and they were generally eating it rather than smoking, it could make a normal person temporarily crazy, a kind of a hashish insanity, as it were. And therefore, that this model psychosis, and that's where the concept originated with Moreau de Tours, that was, later became very much part of the discussion, the scientific or the politicized science discussion around LSD in the 1960s. This idea that a drug can create, will cause a normal person to go crazy. Reefer Madness later sort of picks up on this theme. But so he looked at that and he said that, you know, this could be a very useful tool, hashish. He took it himself, because if a doctor takes it, he'd better understand how a person with mental illness was functioning. And he thought that was a good thing. But where his impact was most keenly felt was not in the scientific world, but in the world of literature, because he instigated this club that would meet every month in Paris, starting in the 1840s, the Hashish Eaters Club, the club of Hashish. And the most famous writers, the most influential literary figures in France were part of this. Victor Hugo wrote Hunchback of Notre Dame, Balzac, Flaubert, Charles Baudelaire, Alexandre Dumas, wrote The Count of Monte Cristo and The Three Musketeers. The most popular novelist of his day, these were the preeminent French men of letters. Of course, then later there's Arthur Rimbaud and stuff, but that's after the Hashish Eaters Club already passed. But nonetheless, this sort of marked a point in French literary history. It was a moment in which that the relationship between literature and hashish would crystallize, that relationship in the Hashish Eaters Club. And sometimes, actually, in the literature itself, hashish figured as a part of the plot, or certainly in The Count of Monte Cristo, where Sinbad the Sailor takes hashish and, you know, proclaims it's really speaking about it in these wondrous tones. And, so it was, and again, these were the respected writers, the most popular writers, and they were portraying hashish as sort of a ticket to this, you know, mystical beyond within, something very exciting, and it, how could it not affect how people looked at it? You know, it didn't have the stigma that hashish would later acquire in France and other countries the following century. Where, why does it have a stigma today in France? Because who was that? It's the Muslim kids from North Africa that were doing it in the ghettos of France. It was their way of coping, you know. That's what they had. And it became associated, just like it was pegged as, with blacks and Latinos in the United States in the run-up to Prohibition, the same kind of racist conjunction. But it not just in the French tradition, but you have also in the English tradition, a kind of a hashish eaters club that emerged, the Rhymers Club, later in the century, and it was associated with the Order of the Golden Dawn, which was an occult group. And among its notable members, even though I guess it's supposed to be a secret society, it was no secret the fact that William Butler Yeats, the great Irish poet, the future Nobel laureate, was part of the Rhymers Club and part of the Order of the Golden Dawn, also Aleister Crowley and so forth. Looking at the literary connection, the figure of William Butler Yeats is very significant. But here is a Nobel laureate, a great Irish poet and playwright, who was part of the Rhymers Club, who partook of both hashish and peyote. He didn't like peyote all that much, but he seemed to like hashish. And he was part of a circle in late 19th century Paris that was involved with the Theosophical movement. Madame Blavatsky, she had launched that in New York. And she had a cult following, as it were, literally, in Paris, and William Butler Yeats was a part of that. And there was a group of people around a doctor, Dr. Luis Alphonse Cahenier. He had a circle around him of devotees, if you will, not necessarily toward him, but toward these monster doses of hashish that they were consuming, you know, way beyond what they would consume at the Hashish Eaters Club in Paris in the 1840s. And there, when they would eat the green paste, the poets and the writers associated with the Hashish Eaters Club, you know, they would get really buzzed an hour later or so after meeting a sumptuous meal at this nice hotel, and they'd have an uproarious time. Well, Cagney's circle was also taking hashish, but it was like 10 times the amount. And I mean, the Hashish Eaters Club, they were getting blitzed on what they were taking. So what these guys were doing in the 1890s, Ben Yeats and these, you know, and with the express purpose of stimulating occult insight, seducing the muse, was all the literary and the occult were very much overlapping in this phenomenon. Obviously, not all men and women of letters were into the occult, but there was a very interesting segment where it both overlapped. And then the key personage, to my mind, is Yeats, given his stature in the world of letters. But certainly, there were many British writers who were involved with cannabis in one way or another. Lewis Carroll, the cat. Alice in Wonderland, the Hookah Smoking Caterpillar. There are several others. Jack London wrote about his experience with hashish. He's an American writer. Oscar Wilde, you know, on the other side of that. Robert Louis Stevenson, amazing stuff he wrote, a short story in which he describes his encounter with this, and he's on a ship, and this quirky guy who has this vial of golden oil that cures all maladies, and he's talking about what we now know of today, cannabis concentrate oil, it cures, can treat tumors, it does all these amazing things, stops epilepsy dead in its track. And here Robert Louis Stevenson having a fictitious conversation with a mysterious man on a ship in the 1890s. The guy who wrote, you know, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, very much of a, people think of it as a, you know, a cocaine thing going on in England at the time, for sure. But cannabis was very influential in the literature, and certainly Robert Louis Stevenson, a bohemian, you know, of his day, a hippie before his time, very much into, very significant character in this regard. In the winter spring edition 2013 of O'Shaughnessy's, a Journal of Cannabis and Clinical Practice, published and edited by Fred Gardner, and I'm the associate editor of that project. This is a little piece called Hipper Mr. Jones. In The Amateur Emigrant, Robert Louis Stevenson writes about Mr. Jones, an excellent friend he met on the passage from Glasgow to New York. And he quotes now from The Amateur Emigrant. He was from Wales and had been most of his life a blacksmith, strong and skillful in his trade. His was the nature that looks forward and goes on from one year to another and through all the extremities of fortune undismayed. And if the sky were to fall tomorrow, I should look to see Jones the day following, perched on a stepladder and getting things to rights. He was always hovering around inventions like a bee of a flower, and lived in a dream of patents. He had with him a patent medicine, for instance, the composition of which he had bought years ago for $5 from an American peddler, and sold the other day for £100, I think it was, to an English apothecary. It was called Golden Oil, cured all maladies without exception, and I am bound to say that I partook of it myself with good results. It is the character of the man that he was not only perpetually dosing himself with golden oil, but where there was a head aching or a finger cut, there would be Mr. Jones with his bowel. Now, Stevenson made the acquaintance of Mr. Jones in 1879, a period when American patent medicines were quite likely to contain cannabis and or opium. The fact that an English druggist was willing to lay out £100 for formula suggests that Mr. Jones' golden oil was effective and potent. There's no determining its contents now, but what ingredients besides cannabis and perhaps opium could have had such healing effects? Stevenson, an instinctive bohemian, had smoked plenty of hashish on an earlier trip to France. He came from Edinburgh, Scotland, where William Brooke O'Shaughnessy's went to medical school, and where seeds that William B. O'Shaughnessy sent from India, this is the Gunja seeds, were grown out for possible medical use, and they actually made some of the first cannabis tinctures with that way. And then hashish was referred to by Nietzsche in a very interesting way. He said, if one is depressed, one has to take some hashish. That's a paraphrase of what he said. But I don't know if he was depressed. I mean, he had syphilis, he went crazy. I don't know whether he himself took hashish, but he said the one reference in Nietzsche was very positive. And there's other, you know, in the Germanic tradition, there's a lot of interesting writers involved with hashish or mescaline. There was an early mescaline circle in Europe in the 1930s. Hermann Hesse was involved in that. Ernst Junger. I think Dr. Albert Hoffman was aware of that when he discovered LSD in the 1940s. That was already going on in Europe now for 10 years earlier, 20 years earlier. Long before Huxley wrote about it so brilliantly, so beautifully. And very much the psychedelic and the cannabis world overlap very much in the 1960s, in some ways less so beforehand. But there are forerunners of that, fortes. You look at the surrealist poet. The 1920s are a very interesting period in Europe in terms of hashish and the literary scene, the artistic scene. You have Walter Benjamin in Germany writing about hashish, and brilliant in prose. And then you have the surrealists, Robert Dingo, Jean Cocteau, who were getting buzzed on hash and listening to Louis Armstrong play, you know, Chop Suey Blues, or whatever it was, and you had the phonograph invented at this time, so they could hear jazz, and they were getting stoned, the circle of writers around Andre Breton and so forth, they're very much interested in dreams and provoking altered states of consciousness, where from whence the surrealist inspiration would, you know, emerge. So they're very, very much bound up on these circles, and it was not only writers, of course, because the surrealist movement was, you know, multi-tiered artistic phenomenon. You had musicians, Eric Satie, and painters, Dali, and so on, and many nationalities. And, you know, it had a necessity. Well, it was very much about, it was a very politicized and turbulent era. This was the 1920s. Fascism was rising in Europe. You had the futurists in Italy were in kind of a problematic relationship of what became fascism, but also were interested in drugs and mescaline. Julius Evola, who was considered like the Herbert Marcuse of the fascist movements in Italy after World War II, really, but he was involved with the mescaline circle. And so you had very interesting kind of radical politics on both sides of the spectrum, if you will, if you look at it in linear, which probably isn't the best way to look at it. But the drugs, I think, were always, and cannabis in particular, were always part of a, if not marginalized, a sort of more radical perspective, a more critical of mainstream. Ever since the Romantic movement in the early 1800s, drugs seemed to play this role in European society. And the ironic thing is the drugs come into the colonizing societies from the colonies, always from Africa on the slave ships, from the Arabs under French domination into France. There's an interesting power dynamic there that goes on. It's almost like subversive, you know, in some unconscious, brilliant way. In the United States, there wasn't a lot of folks involved with hashish in the 1840s, 1850s. You know, it comes over as a patent medicine. Really in the 1850s it starts in the U.S. and increasingly become incorporated in that way. But there was it kind of trickled out. It was kind of a recreational cannabis scene, if you will, that was recognized and written about, not extensively, but mentioned in, Scientific American, it might have been, early, right, it's on the record that there was it wasn't just a matter of medicine, people were doing it for self-exploration, for fun, and it wasn't looked down upon. We're talking about the 1800s. So it was a very libertarian time, if you will, in terms of pharmaceutical access in the United States, assuming you were white or had some kind of privilege. Anybody can go into a drugstore and get these things and use it themselves. But then you also had literary folks in America who were always interested. The first, of course, is Fitzhugh Ludlow writing the hashish year. And that's the kind of prototypical, in some ways, the preeminent 19th century American literary statement about cannabis. He was part of a cadre of literary bohemians that included the likes of Walt Whitman and Louisa May Alcott, who wrote about the cannabis-infused bonbons that the women of society ate. Of course, she's the author of Little Women, you know, one of the preeminent women writers in American history, certainly in the 19th century. And she's writing about hashish. Jack London, I mentioned him, but he wrote an essay about his experience. And then again, for the most part, people weren't smoking it, they were ingesting it. It was part of an oral tradition. That was the main relationship that American society had, either through medicine as a tincture or as a literary or self-experiment. Hashish would be consumed, it would be imbibed, it wouldn't be smoked. Maybe very end of the century, in the 1800s, people started picking up on that part of it. And then in the 20th century, the experience is more as a smoke substance, I think, because Mexican Americans who brought it with them during the Mexican Revolution, that was their relation, and you know, that gets passed along in American society. It always stayed marginalized. Pascal Beverly Randolph was a very interesting character, head of the first Rosicrucian Society, apparently underground secret society in the United States. It's a long connection to occult mythology, and I don't mean by mythology false story, but a kind of a mythos. The order of the Rosicrucifixion, it's linked to, in kind of right-wing paranoid minds and you know, ultra-Catholic nut minds, with Freemasonry and anti-papal plots and so forth and so on. And, so he's involved with secret societies, and he's a very, very important figure in what can be called like the American spiritualism moment. It was, again, it was not a Judeo-Christian thing. It was a kind of a and just by the fact that they were, you had the spiritualist phenomena scene that later Madame Blavatsky from Russia, she becomes a really the preeminent figure in that phenomena. Randolph was in some ways before her, and he died the year she took his own life, the year she formed the Theosophical Society in New York. I think that's 1856, if I'm not mistaken, but it was in the mid-1850s. So there's it's an outsider phenomenon, American spiritualism. It's a semi-underground phenomenon. It's outside of the Judeo-Christian mainstream. It's inherently critical of it, the way it, you know, positions itself. Hashish was part of, was of great interest in the American spiritualist scene, in large part because of Pascal Beverly Randolph, who was a mulatto, intellectual, kind of an amateur bathtub chemist who mixed up patent medicines, which he sold on a speaker circuit. There was a time people would go around and say, hey, you buy your thing, and someone would stagger up on crutches, usually faking it, throw away the crutch and run up, you know, drink the thing. This is the kind of stuff that Beverly, I'm not saying he was a huckster in that way, but what he purported to, what he was doing, was selling a hashish-infused tincture that he claimed to have you know, a unique formula for helping people with their sexual problems. He made a bunch of money this way. Apparently, he traveled a lot. He went to Europe. That's where he first came in contact with the medicine of immortality, as the hashish, or the paste, the green paste was called in North Africa. The Barab Damoesque was the name of it, and it meant medicine of immortality. In his travels, Pascal Beverly Randolph encountered hashish, and I think it was in France. I don't know if he went to North Africa, actually, but certainly it was when he was traveling as part of the same trip that he encountered hashish-infused pastries, and he wrote about it in spectacular ways. Again, eating it, which has a more powerful effect, almost like LSD or magic mushrooms, more so than you're smoking a bowl, generally. And so people who were using it in this context in 1970 were really getting high. Pascal Beverly Randolph, in some ways, he bequeathed hashish to the world of American spiritualism, which was dominated later in the 19th centuries by Madame Blavatsky. And she herself is purported, at least by some accounts, I think they kind of want to whitewash the reputation of her and whoever holds the keys to the Theosophical Society now. They don't particularly like to go into this part of her mesmeric trances. Well, how did she get there? You know, she was getting into the hashish, and then she would go, you know, she was quite prolific, right? These almost inscrutable, you know, volumes, The Secret Doctrine, and you know, another one with all about, you know, the Atlantis under the ocean, and the big age before that, the secret, you know, it was wild stuff. But definitely hashish was an important part of her writing mechanism. And it was because she identified with this so strongly and was so blunt in her positive assessments of the hashish experience, it causes the Theosophical Society today, such as it is, it's not a lot going on there necessarily, but they kind of want to whitewash that part of her history. And so they don't like to emphasize that part of it. And of course, in Germany, you have Walter Benjamin, a different kind of writer, brilliant, brilliant social critic, literary critic, kind of, it's been described as a Marxist mystic or mystic Marxist, I don't know what comes first, but his writing in the German language about hashish was quite amazing, and there's an interesting story there. He's in the 1920s, he's Jewish, the Nazis are taking over, he has to flee, he eventually commits suicide to avoid being captured by the Gestapo in France. But meanwhile, the doctor, the social psychologist, the Jewish doctor that gave him the hashish as part of an experiment in Germany, social psychology was associated with an effort to help working class drug addicts, you know, soldiers, ex-soldiers who were down, and it was a phenomenon in the Weimar Republic. There was a lot of drug issues, and so these social psychiatrists were looking at hashish as a curative, and that's the context in which Benjamin experimented with it in brilliant writing. But the Jewish social psychiatrist, a doctor in Weimar, Germany, who turned Benjamin onto hashish, Fritz Frankl, he had to flee, of course, when the Nazis came to power as well. He fled to Mexico, where he fell in with the circle of turned on revolutionaries, including, he was tight with Leon Trotsky, who I don't know if he was getting hot, but certainly Diego Rivera and Frida Kahlo were, and they were all part of a very interesting left-wing revolutionary circle in Mexico. It was very friendly to hashish, but again, I don't know if Trotsky had anything to do with it. So in all these different countries in Europe, the literary traditions were very bound up with cannabis. Of course, later in the United States, you have the Beats, Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, William Burroughs, who celebrated pot smoking, tea smoking in their literature. Burroughs attributed many of the scenes in Naked Lunch to his use of cannabis as a creative stimulus. Ginsberg wrote parts of How under the influence of hashish, or weed, probably more likely than hashish. Kerouac, I mean, he was excessive with all drugs. He smoked 16 joints a day in Mexico. He's notorious, you know. So drugs are very important part of the beat scene, but the beats, of course, are very important to our history because they, in some ways, are the transition belt between a more marginalized cultural relationship with cannabis. In the jazz scene, it's an African-American scene, a Latino scene, but it's not a mainstream white scene. And yet, this is segregated in America. And it was the beats that really took the jazz cat's herb and brought it into mainstream America. I mean, the key transition. Mission built in that regard. Of course, Allen Ginsberg was in some ways the prototype pot activist, and your pot is fun. And the first public anti-marijuana demonstration, at least on the East Coast, was the first. And you know that picture resounded around the world in the 60s, pot is a reality, pot is fun. So he wasn't just someone who wrote poems about marijuana, LSD, mescaline, and so forth. But influenced so many people. I remember speaking to Michael Aldrich, you know, a very eminent cannabis scholar. He said the first time he saw the word marijuana in print was in Ginsberg's poetry. It was that kind of thing. So it's not that just that they wrote about it, they used it to write, but they became advocates, and that's a very important part of the story, too. Hashish has played a very interesting role in the Islamic world, the Muslim world. The Ottoman Empire was the empire for a long time. 1300s and for several hundred years, but the relationship with marijuana was kind of mixed because sometimes it would be everything was cool and relaxed, and other times you get some crazy sheik or emir, you know, running the show for 12 years and bans it. But never did they ever ban the medicinal use of cannabis. It was always recognized in the Muslim world, even if sometimes politically and legally it was, you know, going back and forth. And you know, it comes when you follow the trajectory of cannabis from its presumed origins in the Kush, the southern Himalayan foothills, and just all around, not just the southern, the Himalayan foothills on both sides, and spreads from there northward and southward. But southward it goes into India, northward China. In both countries, it has a very important medicinal role in the cultures, and religious role, ceremonial role. More so than literature, because literature wasn't really being written. You know, the first pharmacopoeia from Emperor Shen Nung, I think 2700 BC, he's the emperor that bequeathed tea. You know, he taught humanity about how to drink tea, or whatever, you know, that you should drink tea. Quite an amazing thing. Well, it was only years later, hundreds of years later, that they compiled the pharmacopoeia that had been assembled in his time under his supervision, and cannabis was considered one of the half dozen elixirs of immortality. And it was said to be a very unusual medicinal hemp. Ma is very unusual as a medicinal herb because it had both strong yin and yang energies. And so now, thousands of years later, what the scientists discover? The cannabis. It's a dialectical plant. It has compounds with opposite effects. There's THC, psychoactive, CBD, non-psychoactive. They mix in interesting ways. They make each other more therapeutic in certain ways, yet they have opposite effects in other ways. So there it is, yin-yang energies. And so much in modern science today, which is going, as amazing breakthroughs are going on in terms of understanding the brain, as a result, ultimately, of research that began as research into how cannabis affected the brain. But the science very much confirms the wisdom of the ancients. That's what I find. And that, so in China, you have the first mention, the first pharmacopoeia ever written, the first assemblage as a medical text mentions cannabis as a very important medicine. And in India, much the same, but it's also more pronounced as in a religious context and just a ceremonial, everyday context. And it was more psychoactive, it was more southern. You know, China, it kind of went from there in the hemp direction into northern Europe, into Russia and so forth. It migrated that way. But from the south, it goes from India through Persia and into the Muslim world. And again, it has this ambiguous relationship. But and from the Muslim world, it goes in part into, because it became colonized ultimately by France, much of the North Africa, the hashish or the goes into Europe, and it also goes into South, into Africa. And from Africa, seeds on the slave ships come to the United States. So what comes over in Africa? It's an oral tradition. It's a musical tradition. It's jazz. It's the rhythms of jazz that come over on the slave ships with the cannabis seeds, and from the same exact cultures that, you know, jazz historians trace to the rituals of and the percussive beats and the fire burning and the cannabis being placed on the fires. People, you know, this is part of the tradition where jazz ultimately comes from. So you could talk about, I see that as a kind of literature, but it's a rhythmic literature. It's a spoken word. You know, it's scatting. It's very primal. There's no coincidence that the slaves that were, the people that were brought over and made into slaves, when they brought these seeds with them, they brought this whole they brought a cultural context with them too, and it was the context of what become jazz and blues. I learned recently that there were slave ships going to Mexico, not just initially it was going to Brazil, what became Brazil, and in South America, and of course into North America as well. But Mexico apparently they brought the seeds on the slave ships, and that's how cannabis first came to Mexico, which is kind of a new wrinkle for me. But yeah, it's very interesting. And why does cannabis become illegal? You know, it was a politically opportune. It was bureaucratic self-interest at play. It was self-preservation. Also racism. I think those are the two main factors. I mean, there's speculation that, you know, DuPont wanted to suppress hemp. Hearst wanted to monopolize the newspaper, paper access, because he had a lot of forests and so on. And, you know, it may, in fact, exactly been what's going on. You had DuPont seeing a potential competitor to its synthetic chemicals and wanted to squash it. The problem is with that, there's no evidence. It's an interesting speculation, and again, perhaps it's right on the money, perhaps it's a bullseye. But we know for sure there was a racist campaign involved, that cannabis was associated with marginalized ethnic groups, and in an overtly racist way, with sexual tinge, fears, being played upon them. Black men and white women there would be sexual contact with them, induced by cannabis use. And this was and it's a threat to women, threat to children, or the assassin of youth. This is a theme that keeps being played out in American culture, even though the drug wars are losing at this point. They still play that one incessantly. So, you know, why? I think to me that is sufficient to explain what happened. That Harry Anslinger was facing the potential elimination of his entire new department, the Federal Bureau of Narcotics, instituted in the early 1930s after alcohol prohibition ended. They spin off, and some of the prohibition officers are incorporated into this new organization, the Federal Bureau of Narcotics. It's the Depression, there's budget cutbacks. They're looking at this thing as to do nothing. It's basically a bullshit agency. Cut it. Well, he has to come up with a reason. So he convinces Congress there's this terrible threat, this reefer madness, this assassin of youth, raping white women, black. This was what was going on, and the culture was being pushed out by both the government and the media through the Hearst papers, because he has his own reasons to go after marijuana. He was an anti-Mexican bigot. This was the Mexican-Americans' drug of choice, recreant of choice, so forth and so on. And there are other things going on as well. But to me, that's enough to explain why things played out. Congress, you got a bunch of idiots there, and what's going on. you know, Roosevelt, he's got other things on his mind, and a little heavier right now. There's fascism coming up in Europe, and there's this fascist pig, Harry Anslinger, doing the same thing that Hitler's doing, playing up, really literally the same. That's what the drug war propaganda, there's a direct correspondence. Time-wise, it's happening at the same time, and in terms of the way they scapegoat the other in racist tones, in this case, it's the marijuana smoker, the deviant drug user, and in Germany, it's the, they had a word for it, the drug war to keep the race clean, you know. It's a striking correspondence, and it should be pointed out. The drug war is a very much a fascist kind of phenomenon. That's its roots, and it's persisted in American society. Even when the myths get discredited, they seem to, it's like a vampiric thing. You can't kill them. You need ultra garlic or kryptonite. And they just keep going on. They keep being reborn as reefer madness light. Yeah, now we're, you know, it still causes schizophrenia. You know, all this stuff for which there's no science for it, but they keep churning it out. The cannabis in music is a powerful, strong leitmotif and smoke signals. I do a lot on music there, all kinds of music. Cannabis is so central to it. You think about jazz, of course, Louis Armstrong, notorious. The whole Viper scene, it was the cannabis was celebrated in the lyrics, you know, by many jazz musicians. And it certainly influenced this kind of bouncy rhythm that jazz acquired, the Viper music genre, the specific subgenre of jazz was very significant. Because Louis Armstrong was so central a figure as a Viper, not just as a jazz musician, it lent a kind of cultural, you know, it gave it some street cred, but more than street cred, because Louis Armstrong was planetary cred. You know, he was huge. He was the first black superstar. His music is listened to every day all over the world. And that he was so intimately associated with cannabis was significant in and of itself. And, you know, many other jazz musicians, certainly. But not just jazz. You look at every genre of popular music today, and you see, you know, cannabis is central to the experience. Country music, Willie Nelson, you know, maybe say more. He said he's credited cannabis with saving his life, because as a harm reduction thing, he started smoking more and he's drinking less, and finally he wasn't drinking it at all, got off cigarettes. And he's very, very open about that. There's no doubt about that. Rock and roll, I mean, come on, the Beatles, getting turned on by Bob Dylan. Cannabis part of the folk scene in the late 50s, and it was sort of mixed in with the civil rights movement and so forth, and the kind of new left where it emerged from culturally, very much influenced by cannabis, again, because the beats are a part of that. You know, Dylan turning on the Beatles, that's a signature moment in the 1960s, the first time the Beatles smoked pot at a hotel in New York City. It's August 28th, 1964, exactly 1 year after Bob Dylan played at the Big March on Washington, where Martin Luther King gave his I Have a Dream speech. Dylan played Peter, Paul, and Mary song, but the answer might for Blowing in the Wind. Dylan sang Blowing in the Wind at that festival, and Dylan was a pot smoker, and he was part of a pot smoking scene. He was influenced by Reading Ginsburg and the Beats, he says so explicitly, and the Beatles, I mean, you know, their biggest rock and roll band in the world. But it wasn't just the Beatles. Cannabis was everywhere in the rock scene in the 60s. And, you know, I mean, take another hit. Don't Bogart that, what, my friend? I mean, you go on and on, cite examples, you know. But then the Beatles, I'd love to turn you on. I mean, this is the Beatles telling this is the greatest rock album ever. You know, Sgt. Pepper's, and they're singing, I'd love to turn you on. And it wasn't just about LSD. The Beatles were part of a social movement, countercultural movement, anti-war movement in Great Britain that was very much infused with cannabis and psychedelics, just as it was in the United States. What other kind of reggae? I mean, come on, Bob Marley. It's marijuana music, hip hop, Snoop Dogg. Again, cannabis very, very prominent in the whole hip hop scene. You could say that the cannabis renaissance after the reefer sadness in 1980s, the reefer renaissance in the 1990s, in part, you know, catalyzed by Jack Herrera in his book about hemp and his unified field theory of hemp. But in the 1990s, hip-hop and the whole cannabis scene are merging together in such a powerful way. Maybe that's where the drug war is lost. On that, that's a big turning point in a way. Just one that was the worst with Reagan at the very end there. Jack's with his book, preaching next to the Washington Monument, high on acid with his his videotape loop of victory through hemp, playing over and over again while he's preaching like a madman, you know, next to this with something. During the last year of Reagan presidency, to me, that's the turning point, right there. You know, it's the lowest, and but it's where it starts to swing back. Yeah, music's part of it. And the medical marijuana scene really takes off after that. Of course, that's the driving force in the 90s and a lot of it. And medical marijuana and hip-hop on the cultural side, to me, it's, they're happening together. And it means we won, right? That was like the DMV info of the culture war, drug war, in my opinion, where that side lost, and now slowly it gets, the politics is catching up. It always takes the politics to catch up long after the culture war. You know, cannabis has a rich history as a medicine all over the world, many different cultures, including the United States. As of the second half of the 19th century, really, is when the cannabis tinctures take hold in the culture and become possibly the most widely used medicine. Medicines in the culture have cannabis as one of perhaps its main ingredient, or mixed with opium, cocoa, whatever. It could be mixed with different things. But cannabis was a dominant component of American medicine, the patent medicine era in the late 19th century. It falls into, I wouldn't say disrepute, but it begins to fade because of two factors, even before Prohibition, which eliminated medicinal uses of cannabis. And that's one of the great, great tragedies of Prohibition that's implemented in 1937. But before that, you had invention of the syringe, but you can't inject oil-based compounds with a syringe. And cannabinoids are oils, they're lipids. Opiates are water-soluble. So with the invention of the syringe, the discovery of morphine, the creation of morphine, it eclipsed cannabis as a painkiller, for which it was widely being used in the 19th century, because of the power of morphine. Even though morphine and opiates don't address all kinds of pain, actually cannabis has a broader range in terms of the kinds of pain it can ameliorate. Still, you know, opiates are great painkillers. Why does it fall into disrepute? Well, first of all, it should be said in the dispensatory of the U.S., when cannabis is described, it's described literally for 100 different ailments, which is phenomenal, the range of ailments that was being recommended for. Which again is very much in sync with what people experience today, and what scientists and what the doctors in California discover firsthand when California legalized marijuana in 1996, and they can actually begin to do certain kinds of research—not federally sanctioned research—but they can observe what's happening with patients. Why did it fall into disrepute? I mean, partly it was those cultural factors. With morphine in the hypodermic syringe, but the legal, the prohibition has a lot to do with it. It ended the use of cannabis as a medicine, or drove it underground, and it had to be rediscovered. And the key figure in my mind that facilitated this rediscovery of the medicinal uses of cannabis, which had been buried when prohibition was implemented, the key guy is Dr. Todd McAree, physician in the United States who was briefly employed, ironically, by the U.S. government, by the National Institute of Mental Health, to oversee its marijuana research in the 1960s, since a lot of young people were taking marijuana, including sons and daughters of congressmen, things like that. They started to get weird about it. What's happening with my son? Does this stuff, does this damage your brain? What's going on? Actually, the government wanted there to be serious research into marijuana for a very brief moment, and they brought on McAree. But that, I don't think they realized where he was quite coming from, because he was already very sympathetic to cannabis. He had, was a user himself. And he went there with a very, very open mind. He thought he was going to do great stuff. They wouldn't let him, but what he did do was scour the depths of the National Library of Medicine and rescued all this old documents that had been, you know, literally gathering dust on a shelf. And he found the original medical paper written by William B. O'Shaughnessy, that was published in 1842, the first account in Western medicine literature of hashish as a therapeutic agent. And he found a whole bunch of reports from the 1850s and beyond, and compiled this in a volume called Marijuana Medical Papers, which is almost like a textbook of all the things you would never learn in medical school. Articles spoke for themselves. So he really kind of triggered the beginning of a rebirth of interest in medical, the medicinal uses of marijuana in the 1970s. When I look at it culturally, the first group to really get into using it, the first phenomenon of marijuana used as a medicine in the United States, in North America, was midwives using it as a birthing aid. Stephen Gaskin's farm in the Tennessee, that's what they were doing, you know. And even before Robert Randall won that titanic court battle where he won the right to use the only medicine that helped stop his glaucoma, which was cannabis, arguing medical necessity. This is in 1976. Even earlier, these women were very consciously using cannabis as a birthing. And I see that it's actually a traditional usage of cannabis going back centuries. It's always been part of the midwifery's medicine bag, as it were, part of the herbal armamentarium, what would you call it? The medicine chest. But then you have Robert Randall, and he wins this very important court case, and about a couple of dozen medical necessity cases came forward in the United States and won the right to use as a medical exceptions to use cannabis as medicine. They would be supplied by the government, 300 pre-rolled, really gnarly, you know, skanky cigarettes. I've seen, been around poor people, they have to smoke this stuff. It's the worst cannabis you can imagine. But that's what it is. They get it from the government. The fact that they still get it from the government today speaks volumes about the schizophrenic relationship that the federal government has with cannabis, saying it has no medical value, while at the same time supplying what I think is now only 4 people left who are grandfathered in after they stopped this program, the compassionate IND program that was implemented as a result of Robert Randall's heroic efforts initially. But that's an important part of the medical marijuana scene, but really the key turning point is AIDS, San Francisco, and the fact that it was the only thing that was helping people with AIDS, and they were dropping like flies. You know, I was living in San Francisco when AIDS was first discovered in the early 1980s. People were getting sick, they didn't know why, and then all of a sudden this weird AIDS went incurable, and the only thing that helped was cannabis. It was the only thing when these very potent protease inhibitor drugs were finally invented that could step, you know, to keep the HIV count down. The only way to keep these medicines down, they were so toxic, you'd throw up, was to smoke marijuana. So it caught on like wildfire. The cannabis as a medicinal substance was emerged big time in San Francisco initially, and then in the rest of California, as a result of Dennis Perone and his efforts with the Cannabis Buyers Club in San Francisco, and then there were other emulators, and it grew from there. But that was really the break. It was a unique situation in San Francisco. The political establishment was okay with it. Perone was willing to do whatever whatever it took. He risked a lot to do this publicly. And 10,000 people joined that club. Most of the people on staff were people with AIDS. At least half the members were people with AIDS. And it was an amazing thing that went on, an amazing humanitarian phenomenon. Dennis is an amazing character in that way. But that, to me, is the turning point, not just medical marijuana, but the turning point of marijuana in American culture. As I step back and look at the history, it's kind of implicit in smoke signals, the way I wrote it up, but I didn't say in smoke signals this was the case. It really is structured like a screenplay where you have 2 plot points. That's your classic screenplay, how it's structured. You know, half an hour into the play, some event happens that sends the story spinning off in a different direction unexpectedly. And then about 30 minutes before it ends, a second event happens, spins the plot again in another direction that you wouldn't expect. So the first plot point for cannabis in the Americas, in my mind, is the 1960s. Totally unexpected that millions of young people would be smoking pot when it was made illegal less than 30 years earlier. And then the second plot point is medical marijuana in California and the breakthrough in 1996 and the Proposition 215, which to my mind, what we're seeing now in the states with the legalization measures passing in Washington and Colorado, to me, in many ways, that's the culmination of what happened in 1996, what Dennis did. It more so a culmination of something than the beginning of something. You know, but we'll see. You know, it's a very dynamic situation now with cannabis and the shifting cultural landscape. But to my mind, the drug war was fought and we won. The drug war is lost. Cannabis won. Cannabis, wherever it has come to in a different culture, as it's migrated around the world, because it was so valuable to people, you know, from culture to culture, from society to society, starting in the Kush, you know, going into India and Persia and the Muslim world in Europe and across the slave ships, across the ocean into the Americas. Wherever it went, it was never rejected. It was always made part of the culture. Even if it became controversial in the culture, it was still adopted by the people, at least some segment of people, so that it stayed there. And then it would move on to other parts of the world, other cultures. And cannabis conquered the world. So, you know, the drug war is lost. They can't beat a plant.